if you didn't do take the time to confront your fears, commit to the process, and do that personal development, you wouldn't have seen growth on the musical side.
Yeah, for sure.
Welcome to Keep Taking Ground, the Saxophone Podcast. I'm your host, Jesse Ryan, and today's guest was born in Santiago, Chile, and began playing the saxophone when she was just 6 years old. She started performing and touring in her early teens and went on to earn a degree from the prestigious Berklee College of Music in Boston. In 2013, at age 24, she became the first female musician and the first South American musician to win the Thelonious Monk International Jazz Saxophone Competition. She's released 6 albums as a leader, and her music has been described as cultured, emotionally weighted, and purposeful by the Boston Globe. Melissa Aldana, welcome to the podcast. How are you doing?
Good, and you?
I am doing well. I'm so excited that we could finally get to do this. You've been somebody that I've really admired for a really long time in terms of your approach to music. And we were talking earlier, and your passion and your love for music and jazz and the tradition is so potent. So it's really a pleasure to have you here today.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thank you for being a part of this. I want to start right at the beginning. We heard already that you started playing the saxophone at age 6, and that's not the norm. So let's talk about that. How did you start playing the saxophone, and how did you come up through music?
Yeah, well, my father is a saxophone player, mm-hmm. and my grandfather was a saxophone player as well.
Wow.
He used to play tenor. So I grew up seeing my father doing lessons, and I don't remember my grandfather. He died when I was around 5.
Okay.
But I was just always, I was always amazed by the instrument, you know. And my dad one day was doing a group lesson with some other people, and they were playing like a saxophone quartet tune, and they needed like another saxophone to play a few notes. And I was around 6, and I was always going around, and I was like, let me play. So he was like, okay, there you go. So he gave me the alto, and I fell in love, you know.
Wow.
And from what I hear from some other people that were friends of my dad or students, like my dad was very strict, you know, mm-hmm. like waking up before going to high school and practicing, you know, or like
wow.
doing hours and hours. But I don't have any like bad memories. I just really love that. I really remember like loving the process so
wow.
much, you know,
yeah.
just really loving like getting better since I was a very young age. So
mm-hmm.
that's how it started, basically.
Amazing. And you started performing and touring in your early teens. Like, do you remember your very first professional gig?
Well, I did some things in Chile. I was playing jazz clubs, you know, but I will say like I really started with the experience of playing and traveling mm-hmm. when I moved to New York.
Okay.
You know?
Okay.
Yeah, before, I mean, I was always playing little gigs here and there. I was playing in Santiago, but to me, like, it really started when I moved to New York and I started playing with, or even like at Berklee, you know, the experience of playing with people that were much better than me.
Right. So you went on to study at Berklee. And what was that experience like for you?
I don't even know how I make it. I was 18. You know, I think that I was sort of running from my family too. So it was kind of like I was just wanted to leave.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of made the thing a little bit easier, you know.
Okay.
I didn't went through that like homesick, or I was
right.
just like so happy to finish high school and get out of there.
Yeah.
But you know, like when I was at Berklee, I didn't speak English when I moved there. So that was, I think that because of that, like I couldn't take much advantage of everything. You know, I some lessons, I would like, I just practice a lot. I hang out with George Garzon, that was my main mentor.
Mm-hmm.
Bill Pierce, Greg Gosby, De Santoro, Hal Crook. But like all the other classes, I kind of barely made it, you know. But then being around people that play on a much higher level than me, that really inspired me a lot, you know, and also being able to study with people like Joe Lobano.
Yeah.
I mean, as I mentioned, the other ones I mentioned before, mm-hmm. like it really kind of humanized the process, you know, because being from Chile, you look at these people and it's like, God, you know, like, it's like, how does George Garçon play like that? Like, and talking to them, it made me understand that, yeah, one thing is talent, but a lot of has to do with commitment, you know, wanting to be a better version of yourself, a lot of practice, like frustration, like it's the beauty of life, growing personally, everything.
Wow.
And so when I took lessons with them, I always asked about the process, you know, and it's something that I always encourage my students as well. Think about the process, you know, because practicing one thing, but like how do you get there from where, you know? So that was the most important lesson I had at Berklee.
That's great. You may not know this, but when I was at Berklee, I would sometimes stop outside of your door and listen to you practice.
Oh, really?
Really, really, really. I was there at first in the summer semester of 2008. That was my first semester in there, and that was the first time I saw you. I don't think we ever spoke, but I knew who you were. So just like, because I was pretty much starstruck when I was at Berklee. I came from a small island, first time being away from my first time leaving the Caribbean, because I had traveled within the Caribbean before, but it was a culture shock and pretty much starstruck as well. So getting the opportunity to listen to and be around people like yourself was really, really amazing for me. You know, that at that time, people like Justin Faulkner were around, and Mario Castro, and Clay Lyons. There's so many other names that I'm forgetting now, but
The cultural shock was for me too. I had a cultural shock, but it took me a little bit longer to understand it because I needed to learn how to speak English first.
Right, right. So did you ever take any formal classes, or you just kind of learned along the way?
I mean, I took some lessons at Berklee, but then I really learned just watching Family Guy. That's where my and then, as couple of years ago, I was like, okay, it's really time to get my shit together, you know? Mm-hmm. So I started reading a lot of books, and my pronunciation is still not the best, and I'm not aiming to speak like an American, but, you know, just gathering as much vocabulary I can in order to express myself freely, you know, but it took a long time for me to just stop making the transition from thinking in Spanish and then talking in English. That was the first thing I really needed to get rid of.
Yeah. Do you see any parallels between the process of learning a second language and musical development?
And what?
And musical development, like learning musical language.
The process to whatever you do is always very similar, you know. I mean, of course, like if it's different genre or whatever, but it's just about like really studying, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And a commitment and wanted to do it and wanted to do it good, you know. So in that sense, I think that they're very similar.
Yeah, just commit to the process and get through it.
Exactly.
Yeah. As you know, the title of this podcast is Keep Taking Ground, and I want to create a resource through these conversations for people to be inspired and be empowered to keep taking ground in their personal and creative and professional journeys. We've talked a little bit about, you know, how you started playing the saxophone, but now I'd like to talk about what you value in some of your saxophone heroes, and also what are you in pursuit of? What is your ground, you know?
Yeah. I think that my purpose is a journey, you know. Hopefully become free one day, you know, before the end of this life or the next one or whatever it is, you know, just like freedom of expression.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that is why like all the hours of technique, all the hours of trying to find what is the sound, all the study of harmony, you know, transcribing solos and gathering information so I can forget about all of that And I can forget that the saxophone is, look at the saxophone as just, you know, an instrument, a piece of metal, but it's just like a way for me to express what I'm feeling at the moment. So that is my purpose. And so meaning the journey to get there. And the things I admire, well, you know, there's one thing that I hear in all the musicians I love is sound, time feel, and the way they express themselves, whatever that means, you know. So that is the thing that I'm always looking for, you know, just like how personal, like how honest is the playing. And I think that you can hear that. You can totally hear that, you know. And also the other thing is that, you know, I love people that I see constantly evolving.
Right.
In one way or another one, you know, like it's not that you're going to play super different. I mean, nobody, Coltrane was a genius, you know, but what I mean, like that evolving, like just trying to be a better version of yourself. And you can hear that in the music, you can feel it, just even, you know, when you hang out around musicians, people that you admire, the kind of music that they play. So to me, that is like, that is the purpose, you know, trying to be a better version of yourself every day, whatever that means, whatever you can do in order to achieve that.
Yeah, I love that. The one thing you said yesterday that I love is that the journey is the purpose.
Yeah, you know, and also, actually, I think that that goes on a personal level too. You know what I mean? Like with all this quarantine, I've been living alone, you know, so it's a lot of time to think, a lot of time to confront some things that you don't confront, you know what I mean? Just, I think that it's a global experience right now, you know, and one of the realizations is that, like, what is the purpose in life? Like, why am I here? The purpose is just the journey.
Wow.
That's it, you know, I'm trying to make the best out of that, you know, so that is the way I feel about my personal life, you know, it's just leave it and trying to make the best out of it, and the same with music. And I can see, I can really understand how both are related right now.
Right, yeah. What's the one thing that you think has become like part of your DNA as a saxophone player? I mean, you've been in the public eye for a while now, and you're very accustomed with accolades and compliments, but let's put that aside now and just, what is one thing that you are proud of, or something that has become part of your DNA as a musician? And yeah,
I think that, like, the like, you know, like really the commitment to the music, you know. So I'm very, like, I'm not on the, well, I was on the other side when I moved to New York, you know, like it was really, it's been a long journey, you know. It's not that I came here and, like, I won the Monk, and it, like, it's, I've been here for a while,
yeah,
in like 12 years.
Yeah.
You know, but, like, the one thing is just, like, is that, like, I want to get better than myself, you know, and that is the most important thing for me. So what I wanted to say before is that I feel so lucky that I have the opportunity to be traveling with my band and play my music, and also be picky. I want to play with this, you know. I feel very spoiled, but that wouldn't mean anything if I don't feel like I'm doing my best, and if I'm able to practice, I'm like trying to do something that is meaningful for me, you know. So that's why I'm trying to escape out of situations where I'm like, it's just a gig. I just can't take it, you know, like, because it's just so much, it's so much work, you know. It's so hard. You know, it's beautiful, but it's so hard. It's just like determination and like being time alone and thinking, and that I just want to try to go for that every time I play, you know. So I think that's the one thing that defines me, like just giving my 100% in any situation. So even if it's a brunch gig, or it's a session at home, or whatever it is.
Just constantly staying hungry, just to keep evolving and going after. Yeah. That's great, Melissa. You know, just chatting with you and you sharing a bit about, you know, your desire to keep evolving and all of that, there's a sense that you always want to be playing on the edge of your musical ability. And I hear that coming through your music as well. Just like always being on the vanguard, on the edge of what you can do. Can you just talk about, you know, what that means to you, and how it affects your sound of the sound of your band and your writing and all of that?
Yeah, I mean, for me, always being on the edge, it means like, and it's something that I dealt with, it's like ego, you know, which is the same thing on a personal level, you know, like it's an essence and then it's an ego that makes us much functional in this world, like the ego that is telling us you are supposed to be like this and society tells you that you need to be this and you need to fit into this and at this stage you have to be a man, blah, blah, blah. That is ego, you know, that it doesn't let us see the reality, the beauty of like what you actually really feel and is meaningful for you. So I see the same thing in music, and this realization just came this past couple of weeks, you know, but I remember, and I deal with, I sort of deal with this purpose when I was at Berklee. I don't know if you remember Wallace.
Yeah.
It was so vibey. I don't care if I say it right now. Everyone was vibing their ass off.
I went to Wally's once and I never went back.
It was intense. It was horrible, you know? and also I didn't speak English. And then I was like, oh, because I'm a girl, I'm from like, oof, you know? And I remember the first time I went there and I left crying, you know? I was like, I just felt horrible. They were playing like at Kurt Rose in Wilkinson. I remember Jackie's place. And then they were playing... I went there and I played My Shining Hour and they started changing keys and they were playing like super fast, like really trying to like kick your ass. And I'm so thankful for the experience. I understand now, you know, because there were two options, you know, and I think it's the same thing on a personal level. It's like either you confront your shit or you just quit, you know, and it's a tendency on a personal level, like when we hide into something because we don't want to confront that. So I told myself, I was like, I didn't come to Berklee to be a crying baby. I just cried. Like, what is it? You know, like, it impacted your life. And I was like, you know, I need to confront this fear because I think that this ego part is really going to play against what is the real purpose, which is the journey, you know? And so I didn't know the tune, and I remember I went back and I learned My Shining Hour in the 12th keys, and then I learned all the Kurt Rosen Wilken tunes, and then I kept going, and it was like still uncomfortable, you know? And then at some point, it was like, why am I afraid of? And this question came to mind many times during this last year, and you're going to keep coming, like, why am I afraid of? Why, like, and it's ego, because ego tells you have to sound like this, and this is means to be like a killing saxophone player playing all shit, you know? So I went there until I eventually got the gig, and I was very thankful for all the vibing because it really made me grow up a lot, you know? And I think that is the one place where people are always trying to encourage my students, you know, like, oh, well, jam sessions suck and blah, blah, blah. But it's not, it's about like making something very important out of that, you know, which is like, it doesn't matter, you know? So for me, it's like, and I went back to that same situation when I was in New York, like I was terrified to go to smalls and everyone was vibing, you know, and it was very intense. So I was like, if I can go there and trying to be in the moment, you know, just not play automatic pilot, not trying to impress anybody and trying to make the band listen to me, I'm practicing, you know? And so I went there every night. I was younger too, so I had the energy to do it, which I don't know. But I remember, like, I had, like, a good couple months. I was like, nobody's listening to me. So I went there. I was like, I just want to play super soft and very few notes. And, you know, like, just going into the stage and playing very few notes and not, like, blow the horn and blah, when the rock high group is there. It's like, it takes courage, you know? Right. It takes, like, non-ego. It takes to really understand, like, be mature, you know, and that was the lesson that I wanted to have regarding
that's so important, and that's something that I also connect with, because I mean, from my time at Berklee and then even moving to Toronto here, I was never too interested in putting myself in a situation of like those vibey situations. And so I didn't go to a lot of jam sessions just because of that. But at the same time, I still think that there were some lessons that I didn't learn at that time because I didn't confront those moments. And now I'm going back. And so, you know, it's what I'm hearing from what you're sharing is it's not just the ability to stay on the edge musically, whether that's it pushing the bounds of the saxophone or pushing your ability to play faster or any musical concept, but even personally, staying on the edge of your ego and confronting the things that you need to, so that you're growing both personally and musically at the same time.
Yeah. Being uncomfortable, I think that is one of the most important lessons I learned in this quarantine, to be honest, you know? Being really like, okay, it's no gigs, because I always have, you know, I always have the passion to practice, blah, 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 but like I'm talking, you know, without getting deep, like on a personal level, mm-hmm. really uncomfortable, you know, like I separated, like getting divorced in March, you know, so I was like, I have so many gigs, I'm not gonna deal with anything, and then boom, mm-hmm. I was alone for like, I don't know how many months, and I'm right. still living alone here, and mm-hmm. being uncomfortable is suck, but it's one of the biggest lessons I ever had. And I can see how I knew this from when I was younger regarding music, you know? So the personal part and the musical part were not connected, mm-hmm. you know? So a lot of answers to my personal thing, it was like in the way that I was doing music, you know? So right. that's why I always make emphasis. It's like, if you want to move forward, you have to be uncomfortable. You have to accept where you are. You have to accept the journey, you know? So the same when you're transcribing and you want to sound like somebody, you get to a point where, okay, I get what Mark is doing, so now I have to let it go. And it's a really hard thing to do because you're used to think like somebody else, you don't have identity, and then it's this fear of like, what are my ideas, you know?
Right.
So that uncomfortable part of the process is as important as all the hours practicing and trying to master somebody else's voice on the instrument.
And that's great. That brings us to another thing. So your process of transcribing, and know that when we were chatting earlier, that transcribing has been a huge part of your process of musical growth, and being really thorough in the process, not just transcribing the notes or the rhythms, but trying to embody the feeling and the articulation and how they think and approach the music. Can we talk about your process of transcribing and this whole that applies to, you know, that idea of trying to stay on the edge and trying to push to evolve?
Yeah. So, well, I was lucky that I had a crazy dad that would spend like 8 hours a day transcribing Charlie Parker with me. And he never told me how to read. Actually, I learned how to read at Berklee. You know when they have those ratings, like I had mm-hmm. 7 on everything, and on sight yes. reading, I have minus 7 with anything. But it was a very important lesson there because I understood what does it mean to transcribe. You know, mm-hmm. so that's how I learned about language. My dad taught me, you know, he always encouraged me to think, you know, so we did a lot of theory, we practiced sound, but like he taught me how to learn language through transcribing. Like through taking one phrase, and I remember back then I was like, what the fuck is this? Like I didn't even like Charlie Parker, but I would just believe in him. Mm-hmm. But like he will like spend hours me trying to imitate the ghost notes or the vibrato. Like hours and hours and hours, you know. And I know, you know, like sometimes I have students that I talk about this and they're like, but there is so important, you know. So to me, transcribing is important because as we were saying before, like sound and time field and the way that you express are concepts, you know. So
yeah.
So by transcribing and by having a hero, you fall in love with, you understand what you like, mm-hmm. you know, what speaks to you.
Right.
So I think that there's two very important part of the process, you know, at least for my generation, you know, but it's something that actually I hear on every musician that I transcribe. I can hear the history of the music, you know? Mm-hmm. So also that tells me something, like it's meant to be like that. You know, like somebody like Sonny, who is somebody that I admire so much, I hear a lot of Coleman Hawkins, you know? Mm-hmm. Breaker, Joe Henderson, Martin and Ward March, Benny Golson, Don Byas, everyone is coming from somewhere.
Right.
So yeah, when I transcribe how I do it, first of all, like, I don't know, I've been doing it for years, you know, but like the one advice I could say is that like start, if you're new at it, like start with something that really makes you passionate.
Right. Because something that you could identify with.
Yeah. It doesn't matter if it's Kenny G or it's Charlie Parker. It doesn't matter. Something that is like, oh, you know, because it's very deep. You're like, it takes a long time, you know? Mm-hmm. And then as you grow older, like then you start figuring out the shit on your own. You know, like I remember when I was at Berklee, they were like, no, transcribe this and go back. And then I didn't go back until I was like, oh, okay, I understand now. I have to go back if I want to move forward, you know?
Yeah.
So then I choose a solo, and the commitment that I have is that, like, and this is with everything that I practice, like everything that I start, I finish it, you know? Even if a solo is like 30 minutes, I have to finish it, you know? So I'm not jumping from one thing to another one. And also I focus
on one. So you're narrowing your focus.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I mean, I'm just not that smart. Like I can like do this and this and this, and then it's just not the way I am, you know? And so also you have to do whatever speaks to you. But I basically married the person like for 3 to 4 years. Mm-hmm. I don't even like for me, I mean, at this point, and at least when I was at Berklee too, like it wasn't about the phrases or the notes or the licks, you know, like I did that when I was very young, but my process is like, okay, practice as much harmony and understanding of the instrument and control, and then just transcribe, just eat it. Right. Like one solo after another one, memorize it.
Yeah.
You know, I use transcribe. So I usually put the transcription like on 25%, like where I can hear all the painful details. Like that is where is the real shit. That is transcribing, you know? Mm-hmm. And it gets to a point where I just get it. You know, something makes click in my mind. I'm like, oh, I don't even know what is harmonically speaking. And that happened with Mark, but I was like, I can hear and I can feel it. And it's enough. Right. I got it. So then I have to let it go, you know? So it's not really a secret, you know? I think that the thing is that it's just like how much commitment I put in.
Right. I was just going to say, you know, throughout all of these conversations that I've been having, the one thing is that has been coming up is that there's no shortcuts. You know, my goal here with these conversations is to, I really believe that in-demand and award-winning saxophone players know something that the rest of us don't know. But so far it's being revealed that it's not necessarily some magic, you know, it's the simple things like committing to something, narrowing your focus, being committed to the process and not necessarily the results of it, staying on the edge of your ego and overcoming those fears, as all those things that you've been sharing, things that we've heard echoed from our parents to other things, and those things, you know. And it's so important too, because like you were sharing earlier, when you got a chance to meet your heroes, it humanized the process. And absolutely. I think, you know, a lot of times in I think there's a culture in jazz, or let's say contemporary music, where musicians that we admire are deified, and so
they what? Sorry?
They are deified. They become deities. You know, we look up to them like gods. And so I think that influences our own process of musical growth, you know, where we don't consider ourselves and approach it in a very personal way, you know, because I get the sense of from what you're saying that, you know, if you didn't take the time to confront your fears, commit to the process and do that personal development, you wouldn't have seen growth on the musical side.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
You know, accepting how you play, with the good and bad, you know. I'm still like, I'm happy with a lot of things, you know, but I accept it. Mm-hmm. You know, so that I think that is so, I can totally see how, even though I'm perfectionist, you know, but I can totally see how it's related to, like, I mean, even Sonny Rollins say, I mean, a lot of elders say this, like, you just have to not care, you know, stop caring so you can just really talk. Wow. And that is hard. That, I mean, to me, that is the freedom. That is the ultimate goal. you know, mm-hmm. and I think there's nothing that you just achieve as you're getting older.
Right. And, you know, you said something that I found was, it was really profound earlier when we were chatting. You said that there's no innovation. I'm paraphrasing what you were saying, but there's no innovation, but there's only transforming information to make it personal.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure a lot of jazz musicians are going to be like, what are you talking about? But but this is my conclusion out of the people that I transcribe and the things I like, you know. Mm-hmm. To me, one of the most innovative saxophone players is Mark Tanner, you know. Mm-hmm. But as somebody that has studied the music, I know that he studied that, mm-hmm. you know. So that is his conclusion with all the tools that he knows, you know, like the constant evolving, but it's coming from somewhere, you know. So it's not like, oh, Martin's playing all these new things. It's coming from somewhere, you know. So that is what I mean. That to me, it feels like everything is being done. So now the only thing I can add is my personal experience and my own vision mm-hmm. about it, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah. And in that way, transcription or transcribing becomes the main tool to keep evolving.
Of course, you know, like I think that like we all, like, I mean, at least in the saxophone players I love, like you can hear that it's a mix of a lot of different people, you know, you can just hear that if you really know. Mm-hmm. So it makes complete sense, you know, and also like, I'm just kind of disattaching from some things because I did a lot of different transcriptions, all 20s, you know, mm-hmm. and I'm 31. So I'm trying to figure out how to put all those things together. But if I'm going to play the way I'm playing, I want to play because I decide to play like that, you know? So if I want to play like completely out, or I just want to play one note and hold one note the whole night, I want to do it because that's what I'm feeling, not because I haven't done my homework, you know?
Right.
So, I mean, at least to me, it's very important to just really understand the history of this music.
Man, it's been a real pleasure just hearing you talk about your process of transcribing and how you began playing the saxophone. And, you know, I feel blessed to have this opportunity to chat with you, you know.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, really, really blessed. I would love us to, before we wrap up this conversation, I would love us to play a rapid fire question game called 3-2-1. I'd like you to share three albums that were influential for you, two saxophone players that were influential for you, and then leave our audience with one piece of advice.
Okay. So albums. Well, Freedom Suite mm-hmm. by Sonny Rollins.
Yeah.
Free by Benny Golson.
Okay.
And then I have to mention Kurt Rosenwilken live at the Vanguard. Remedy.
Oh, wow.
I have to mention that. Like he's... like all that period with Mark and Kurt that is defines so much who am I right now. And then two musicians, you said two saxophone players?
Yeah, two saxophone players, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I would say like, two is hard. I would say Benny Golson and Don Byas, but like I have to say like Mark Tanner is like a big part of those three, so it's like,
that's okay. Let's do three.
3-3-1.
3-3-1. All right.
And then advice. Nothing. Always just remember the purpose is the journey. That's it. You know, I think that makes life easier that way. So that's it.
That's great. Wow. There were so many gems in there, and I feel inspired to keep taking ground in my own personal and creative journey on the saxophone. Thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to chat with me. And my hope is that this conversation would help someone listening. If you want to connect with Melissa directly, her website is melissaaldana.net. You're on Instagram as well, right?
Yeah, Instagram and Facebook. Okay. And also, you know, like I've been posting on Instagram, like some solos, you know, that it's not about the solo itself. I'm just kind of like exposing the process. So if anyone is curious about what does it mean or how I do it, like I put like even a solo by Kurt and Lionel Hampton, like a lot of different things, just talking about the process basically.
Yeah, that's amazing. So if you want to check that out, guys, go check out her on Instagram. What's your handle, Melissa? What's your handle on Instagram? Your Instagram
I think it's Melissa Aldana Sax.
Okay. Okay. All right, great. Thank you so much for taking the time to chat with me. I hope this conversation was both inspirational for you and it empowers you to keep taking ground in your personal, professional, and creative journeys. I'm Jesse Ryan. Thank you for listening. Thank you for being here, Melissa.
Of course, thank you.
All right. I'll catch you on the next episode. Take care. Thank you.